is really an area for pension funds to channel funding into the real economy. And so maybe let me start off with that backdrop. If we look at the Namibia Financial Sector Charter, it was recognizing that Namibia has such a sizable contractual savings base and is deemed as the exporter of net savings. And so they came up with different policy directives to try and ensure that capital is channeled locally. So we ended up with Reg 35, which was the then Reg 28.4, which compelled all pension funds and long-term insurers to invest a minimum of 1.75% of their assets under management into what they termed unlisted investments. Now, this has been well commended by even the likes of the World Bank as sort of innovation to spur capital market development. The intentions are all noble, but I do think today we have to unpack sort of the ideal situation so that we cover risks and address areas and shortcomings and limitations so that we can really all be confident as investors and asset owners allocating towards this asset class and really achieve the sort of policy outcomes that we're hoped for. And so if I just start off recognizing, Rory, that you mentioned all these wonderful things about the benefits of private markets to portfolio construction and the like, I think let's start off our debate, or not debate, our conversation today with governance and risk, so we get the difficult issues out of the way and end off with the compelling argument that, you know, there is a case for private markets allocation. I'm joined by Dugald. Dugald represents the Namcor Pension Fund. And so I think let's start there, because we all pension funds, whether you're large and sizable like the GIPF, that's a defined benefit fund, or whether you're a small defined contribution fund, this obligation was posed on all of us, albeit it allowed for exemptions. But Dugald, I'd like to understand from you, because there is this notion that a lot of the pension funds are unfortunately applying for exemption from investing into unlisted investments. So Dugald, can you perhaps just provide factors that lead to pension funds seeking exemption or having issue with investing into unlisted investments?
Thank you, Sarah. So now we're putting into practice the risk-based approach that Nafisa alluded to earlier. I'm here from a very small fund, not as well coached and well trained as Sarah and Rory on this issue, so I can only speak from experience.
Aristotle.
Okay, I'm not Aristotle, but I'll try my best to emulate him with a philosophical view on this. I'm going to try from my experience. Namcor is a very small fund. We don't even have probably 0.5% of what GIPF represents in terms of our savings or our investment power, let's call it that. Yet, we are all, when they comb the hair, you know, I don't have much hair, but when they comb the hair, they just use the same comb. That's the regulator, whether it's hundreds of billions or a few millions in pension fund assets. Everybody has to toe the same line. Now, in terms of the exemptions, Namfisa do provide exemptions if you are not in an unlisted. But how logical is the whole process then? Because we can understand from GIP that they have lots of money to invest in unlisted. But arguments say, I'm just using 50 million as a fund that the fund has, and then you have to take 1.5 to 3.5% of that and then put it in an unlisted. How logical is that? Brings us back to the problem that we faced earlier. The capacity of the trustees, small funds, normally have in small capacity on the trust to invest it. Where will you find that asset that you can invest in? 1.5% of 5 million. I mean, 10% of 50 million is 5 million. So 1% is, Sarah, help me here with your mathematics. But you get the point. It's, where are we going to get an unlisted asset manager that's going to take 500,000 and invest it? There's no logic in it. So now we are told, no, you can ask for exemption. But is it really necessary? Because then to ask for exemption, again, comes back to the capacity of the specific pension fund. Do you have the capacity to write that exemption correctly, to do it on time? All of these things play factors. So as a small pension fund, our experience, we have exemption on that. But it's not an easy road to take. You need to be well versed in the intricacies of a regulated space. So to come back to your previous question is, the first thing is, as I now alluded to, is the capacity. And added to this capacity is also the burden that is now placed on these small funds. Because as Rory has mentioned earlier, you can't just go there and pick an unlisted. You now have to do due diligence. I mean, with the regulator also mentioned the initiative that's being driven by the financial services sector to train the financial services sector to do better work. But who trains the pension funds to do better work, to be able to do due diligence, to be able to monitor these asset managers? So you have to do due diligence, pick that unlisted, and then appoint that unlisted, then monitor that unlisted, see whether there's stuff that is not kosher. Where there's no logic in how it is served. Therefore, a good thing is the exemption is there, you can apply for it, you'll probably get it. But again, when it comes back to under FEMA, where the responsibility lies, small pension funds will be tasked with these responsibilities. So it's about that capacity of that. And as I mentioned earlier, you have only 50 million to invest. How do you snip it up into those small portions and ensure that your members get a return on it? So again, it comes down to how, in a regulated space where we are protecting the interests of the members, pension fund trustees' job is to firstly protect the capital and then to make it grow. Now, if you snip it up into those smaller sections, the ability to make it grow sort of just disappears, because there's fees, there's all of it. In all of this, your administrator has to take a cut. Your consultant on investments have to take a cut. The unlisted asset managers, they will do drawdowns and they have to be paid some administration fee. All of this is eroding, ultimately, in my view, the investment of the members. So just that, based on that capacity. And then now, let's say, okay, NAMCO small fund says, okay, let's do the exercise. We are compelled by the regulator to do the exercise. Where will we find that investment vehicle that you can put that small amount of money? So now we need to look at, like, what is there. Currently, us, NAMCO, we have an insurance product, a smooth performance fund, which actually helped us during these tough times. But if we have to come out of there and start finding our own funds to invest in, it adds to our cost. If the cost goes up, members' interest go down. And then, what we have experienced now, because we are so small, we don't manage our assets on our own. So we don't have the experience, we don't have the skills. So all of this is just adding to the risk. It has certainly given us insight into what goes on in the global scale. Again, as a small pension fund in Namibia, there's no mechanism for monitoring these unlisted at present, I believe. So if there was something there, it would certainly relieve the burden, or some of the burden, from the pension funds. But as Rory has said, with that, his cycle that is that...
the control cycle.
Yeah. So all of that you have to eventually do. You won't have that type of investment vehicle. So obviously one would, I think you mentioned the infrastructure funds.
Mm-hmm.
That is something that one can look at. And then lastly, I want to say, and I've mentioned it before, is the control mechanism.
Yeah.
Where is the oversight coming from? So from GIPF, your experience, have you been doing the oversight on your unlisted? Have it been successful? How has GIPF's experience been? Because I'm very scared of that. That burden has come to NAMCO pension fund and other small funds.
You've said a mouthful and very, very relevant elements that you've brought in that we should unpack. So we said earlier that even the likes of the World Bank have commended Namibia for taking this approach of compelling pension funds and long-term insurers to invest in unlisted investments. But I think it is due and high time that we do take stock and just assess, because you're absolutely right. The sizes of the pension funds are so varied, and even for a sizable pension fund, particularly in a nascent market like ours, where we just started working in this industry, the cost of investing into private equity can be high. Because as you said, the GIPF is lucky, it has a unit which I head up that's responsible for this oversight and allocation into unlisted investments. But a general smaller pension fund, even a pension fund that's size, more sizable than yourselves, don't have dedicated personnel to monitor these types of investments. So definitely one has to revisit and just assess and take stock, especially because we're moving towards risk-based supervision. How do we do it within a considered risk mitigation and management framework? So our experience at GIPF, and I must say, we ventured into private markets investing before the regulator compelled us to do so, because we do, as Rory earlier showed, believe in the portfolio diversification benefits that this private markets asset class can afford. But even ourselves, we have a lot of pain in investing into unlisted investments within Namibia. So we invest globally into private markets, and I think it's small things like just terminology. So in Namibia, the regulator decided, let's call it unlisted investments. And unlisted investments is so broad, because it should then be any investment, whether it's private equity, whether it's property, whether it's debt that is not listed. You know? And so as Rory's one slide showed, the private markets spectrum has evolved over time, and now you get some different strategies, whether it's real assets like property investing, infrastructure investing, private equity, delving into venture capital, mezzanine, private credit, and the like. And so we're a global investor, and when we just look at how we invest outside of Namibia versus Namibia, I think there's been a missed opportunity. So we started off in Namibia due to legislation that was passed in 2014. And I think our country had a missed opportunity. This was our chance to adopt global best practice and look at lessons learned and come up with a regulatory framework using terminology and using frameworks that are understood and practiced globally. But what we did is we crafted our own little thing here. And the regulator, and that's the reason why I asked the question I asked earlier this morning, is with NAMPISA moving from prescriptive-based to risk-based supervision, are they going to review some of the restrictions they placed on us? So if you look at our market, the regulator regulates the fund managers, and they also decide best practice. So if we go back to Rory's slide on the control environment, in Namibia, the regulator prohibits an independent fund administrator. They prohibit the investor advisory committee. So for us at GIPF, as much as we're this sizable pension fund with over 142 billion of assets under management, and if we go back to that 1.75, we have to at a minimum at least invest 2.5 billion into unlisted investments. And we're happy to do so, but we ourselves also have pains. And so, Rory, I want to circle back to you and just that control environment that you raised. We say that even, so Duke have mentioned all the qualms he has, and we say even a sizable pension fund of our size, the regulator has prohibited this independent fund administration. And if we just contrast that to the listed environment, listed asset managers and pension funds operating that environment have the investor confidence that, you know, certain control mechanisms are in place. I mean, can you imagine if in the listed domain you didn't have a custodian? So please just unpack the importance of the independent fund administration and things like an investor advisory board, because those are not allowed in our market. And as Dugard rightfully said, so even in the likes of GIPF, where it has dedicated personnel, we report to a governing board of trustees who are tasked with fiduciary responsibility to have oversight over these investments. And whether you are big or small, you need the right control environment.
Yeah, thanks, thanks, Sarah. So, yeah, I understand this is a slightly contentious issue given regulation. You know, it has become, there's a global trend towards independent administration. And I think there's, I think perhaps what's part of the issue is the misunderstanding of the point of this, is that I think it's just there's an impression that it's just kind of doing the books. You know, just keeping records. And why wouldn't you have someone, you know, within the private equity fund manager who can, you know, act as the accountant and keep the records, and also kind of help out on deals and wherever else they need to help out. And that's kind of logical. But the problem comes really on the control side. Because really what an independent administrator does is actually much broader than just keeping records. They actually form an extremely important control function in that they're the ones who actually manage the bank account, as an example. They're the ones who must see evidence of reasons for paying out capital and the evidence of what supports any money coming into the accounts. So, you know, for example, in our own funds, we use independent administration. You know, but in the fund of funds that we run in the underlying trust that we invest in, you know, and in both instances, you know, where an investment is going to be made, you know, and it has to go through an investment committee process. There's got to be papers submitted to the investment committee, the minutes of meetings approving the investments, but all of that kind of supporting documentation, all of that is then passed on to the administrator as support for the fact that the investment decision has been properly made. That's all kept as record by the independent administrator, and they'll only actually make any payments once those criteria are actually satisfied. Once they can see that decisions have been properly made, once there's, you know, proper invoices and authorization supporting payments. And all of that, in theory, can be done within the fund manager. But you've got to remember that there's that factor of management override. So in a small, what you find in a private equity fund manager in a local context is that there's just a handful of people. And where you have an internal administration function, you're having an accountant sitting within the team whose boss is the main investment party, is the one calling the shots both from an investment point of view and from the business point of view, and is the one, you know, who has the sway over, you know, whether that accountant keeps their job or not. There's a very strong compulsion for that person, that the accountant within the fund, to do what is asked of them. And there's no within you know, they're actually contracted to work within the required control environment. They can only make payments, and they can only produce do the items that they're supposed to do with the necessary evidence. So it's much better structured, and it's much more difficult for any overrides to take place. This, a very good example, an often cited example of, an argument for this is with all of the shenanigans that happened with Abraj, and many of you would have heard about Abraj, the emerging markets private equity firm imported out of Dubai, I think it is, where they were running multiple funds across multiple locations, and most of it they were actually administering themselves. And there was a breakdown in controls and capital being moved from one fund to other funds. And those lines and those ring fencing around individual funds was not maintained. What happened within the same group was that in the African component, there was actually independent administration. And that actually kept that revenue intact in that particular portfolio, whereas in the rest of the group, that breakdown happened and there was, loss of investment capital. So there's a very clear example in the market of that happening. That said, there's no getting away from the fact that private equity, private markets in general, it's an expensive asset class. It's much more expensive to go and find companies to invest in and negotiate deals, do all the backwards and forwards, work with families, set up governance structures, all of that's required to do deals in the private markets. That's clearly going to be more expensive than trading listed shares, behind your Bloomberg terminal. It's just simply a more expensive model. But the way that the private markets model is set up is that there's a much higher threshold for gross return. So when any particular deal is actually invested in, there's a much higher target of what's an appropriate level of return to allow for all the costs, so that a net return can still be achieved that still makes sense for the end investors. So, in most instances, that means that at the deal level, when an investment committee of a private equity fund actually approves a deal, they're looking for deals that can produce 25% plus over their holding period, 25% annualized returns. And then we typically see, and you'll have some deals that will underperform it. So you can immediately kind of take a haircut from that. And then normally what you'll expect is somewhere between, perhaps a 6 to 8% in most instances of reduction of return to get down to your net returns. So that happens through the cost base that's in the management of the fund, the management fees, the carry or performance fees, however you want to call it. And when you get to what they invest against in the end, there's that net return. So that's what, when you're choosing, and when any of us is choosing private equity funds or private market funds, we've got to focus on how does the investor actually get to that net return. So that, yes, the costs are high, but you can stomach the costs because, even after the costs, you can achieve something that makes sense for you as an investor.
So that is an ideal setting. I think before we move on to one of the things about private equity and we unpack all the not so nice things about it, that's really an ideal world, because if you're in a new market like Namibia where private equity is just taking off, you find that when you get to the end of the term and you must unpack that waterfall distribution, then you might not even meet hurdle. And I think a lot of the things that you're going to speak to is the world impact hurdle over time. So if you don't even have this independent fund administrator, between yourself as a pension fund and the fund manager is already conflicted to be the one tracking returns over this 10-year period to, after 10 years, come and say, oh, okay, this is the performance of the fund, this is the hurdle I've made. And in a new market where you're dealing with pension funds and support, that is often financial services professionals from the industry, but they themselves have never heard of private equity, so they themselves are relying on the fund manager. We have to put all our trust that these people are going to use the management agreement to have due oversight. So I think Dugald is absolutely right in asking who must do all this oversight, particularly in a nascent market like ours in Namibia. So I think the point we want to bring across is that as the regulator thinks about this risk-based supervision, they must review all prudential limits and frameworks and regulations that have been passed where they may not have thought properly through the risk and the impact of those restrictions that have been imposed onto pension funds. But on a much lighter and progressive note, I think with having indicated that it is a rather expensive asset class and the limitations to it, I want to go back to the true benefits of investing into private equity. And as I said in GIPF, at GIPF, we've invested into private equity before it was passed as legislation in Namibia, and we invested into it globally. And so it definitely does have those portfolio diversification benefits for us. You mentioned in your slide, things like reducing volatility, which our listed instruments are so volatile. So just from an overall fund portfolio management perspective. But also, if I just look at, this 45% domestic asset requirement that was once again imposed on us in investing in our market, we certainly as GIPF, I remember at the time when it was passed, we had to find a home for over 7 million in Namibia, almost overnight, or you must comply. And so knowing how shallow our capital markets are and our stock exchange, where were the assets going to come from? And so private equity, as you rightly said in your one slide, does sort of help you to create these assets, right? You can put up a framework where you decide you're going to be a responsible investor. You can align yourself to national development plans and drive capital towards impactful things like infrastructure, affordable housing, financial inclusion within banking services, etc. So these are all part of the beautiful and wonderful things. But what I perhaps would like to understand, and knowing that our young market still has a long way to go, in South Africa, Rory, I know you guys have just been talking about prescriptive assets, and there was a whole hoo-ha about, the regulator can't impose on us, now they want to take our money and put it in Eskom when Eskom is failing. And those fears were also felt here. Is the regulator pushing for 45% domestic asset requirement so they can take our good pension savings and do things with it that, they can't access funding because of poor decisions at Paris settled? Can you just give us a backdrop of how that conversation unfolded in your market in South Africa?
Yeah, sure. It was an intense debate, Sarah. Just about everybody weighed into this debate around the potential for prescribed assets. I think to some extent it was it was a tool that the government used to stimulate debate around how more investing was going to be done in local infrastructure. The extreme position of prescribed assets did get a lot of people thinking, so I think it was effective in that way, but it was also scary for a lot of pension fund investors, pension fund trustees, who were obviously concerned that how are they supposed to, if there was going to be prescription, how are they supposed to make sure that they fulfilled their obligations to their members and did the right thing for their members if they were being told that they had to do something, do one thing or another. You know, we did make the point at the time that there's, you know, in all of our markets, there's that level of prescription anyway. You know, we, in South Africa, we have regulation 28 that says, you know, we can't do more than any, you know, certain limits in certain places. You know, quite a lot of work was done to see how much money is already being invested through, say, parastatal bonds to support the SOEs. And then there was, yeah, there was a lot of work that was kind of done around definitions of, you know, what is infrastructure investing, and to some extent that debate is still going. We're in the process of having our regulation 28 revised. It's had a second draft, but comments went in. The deadline for comments was yesterday for that revised draft of regulation 28. So what that did was it said they upped the allowance for private equity. So they're actually allowing up to 15% in private equity now. And they brought in an allowance for up to 45% investment in infrastructure. So there's quite high allowances, and actually this has been very positively viewed by the market. There's a lot of need for infrastructure investment, and there's a lot of willingness to invest in infrastructure as long as it's in the right form. From pension funds to asset consultants to asset managers, I think the debate has more shifted to should we do it, to more how does this get done. So there's a lot of conversation around, you know, what types of infrastructure assets are actually investable. There's been various some of this progress has actually been sitting in the presidency itself. There's been several committees and other bodies formed that are there to kind of open the ability to invest into infrastructure. And really what's quite encouraging is to see that a government is clearly trying to partner with the private sector. It's not quite there, but clearly that's the intention. So to do that is actually quite a difficult thing in practice. It requires there's quite a lot of overhaul of regulations that need to be done to enable this in practice. But I think what we are seeing is that the government has recognized it doesn't have the money to invest in what's required domestically, and recognizes, you know, we've got a reasonable size saving pool like you do in Namibia, and that partnering, actually, particularly in the area of infrastructure, you can bring quite a lot of discipline from the financial side, quite a lot of discipline both around around selection of projects, and then also kind of the completion of projects, selection of suppliers, all those kind of things. You can bring a lot of discipline from the private sector to kind of partner with the willingness of government and the approvals that are needed from government, and in some cases guarantees and things like that are needed to actually get projects up and line. In the infrastructure space, it's one where collaboration can work quite well. But it's one where also the government needs to prove itself over and over again that it's going to hold true to its guarantees. It's going to hold true to, you know, the ownership and the cash flows of the assets, and you don't get a reneging on those things. So I think when we saw probably 5 years ago now, when there was some debate around, you know, when Eskom was hitting its cash flow difficulties, and there was some debate around whether Eskom would pay the renewable energy producers on time and pay them for the energy that was produced. It was extremely important that government actually came through and made sure that, you know, as the shareholder there, made sure that Eskom did make those payments. Because, you know, without actually making those things happen in practice, you would land up in a situation where there would be a huge lack of confidence in any such partnerships going forward. So it's I don't know that we completely over the prescription debate, but it does seem like we've kind of entered into a different phase where it's about kind of how we invest in infrastructure and the whole prescription side of the defense government fund finance.
Yes, so I think we've sort of moved into that responsible investor category, but you know, interesting that you touched on something and you said your whether you do infrastructure as listed or unlisted or through bonds, you can look through and have 45% exposure.
Yeah, so there's different allowances. You know, the previous draft of this regulation that came out in March this year, and what they actually did in that draft was they added for every line to the Reg 28 allowance. So there was a line for listed equity, for listed bonds, etc. They actually added a column for infrastructure in each of those different asset classes. So they were kind of saying you could have a limit for equity investments into infrastructure and debt investments into infrastructure. That was encompassed within those, you know, within those line items. They've changed that around in this draft to kind of allow for a separate category for infrastructure, but that's for the unlisted components of infrastructure. There is a recognition that it can also fit within these other categories that are already allowed.
Okay, and it might seem that we're laboring on this point of classification, but it's so relevant, and I think these are the things that us as a pension fund body should advocate for, because from a national perspective, policy is being driven and trying to access our contractual savings to compel us towards certain things, which can have benefits for our portfolios. But at the same time, some of them do pose a threat, or they're just not, the different policy directives are not in congruence when it comes to implementation through this regulation. So a key example is our classification. We are told we must invest 1.75% minimum in unlisted investments. When you want to invest in infrastructure using unlisted investments, you now get told no, but unlisted investments excludes property. And if you have infrastructure where it is a component is either land servicing or it's a dam and there's brick and mortar, then the regulator will tell you, no, you can't do it there. So I think it's very important that we review these restrictions and prescriptive restrictions that have been placed on us to make sure what is the impact we're trying to achieve and what is the risk that must be mitigated within that. Do you know, I want to venture back to you. I know we're dropping sentiments all over the place, but is there something that you want to sort of zone into?
Yeah. I have to read my notes. I'm getting old, so I have to consult. The conference title is "The Perfect Storm Is Here." I've been looking at our promotional drive, and I thought, what is the perfect storm? What are we referring to? Are we referring to FEMA? Are we referring to COVID? But what is it all about? Now, looking at what we were discussing, I have another view on this. I said, okay, whatever the perfect storm is, it is here. We've experienced many things over the past few years, and we will experience many things. We have the fish rot, which is out there. It made us look at things differently. But somebody once said that the storm is not only there to bring you problems. And as the Prime Minister says earlier, there's a lot of opportunity. So a storm comes, it washes away all the debt, all the broken stuff, provides opportunity, provides a clear path. So we now need to step in. So I think, coming back to what you alluded to earlier, in the regulator's language of property, maybe it's just a semantics issue. Do they know what the definition of property is? Should we not change the word property to be very specific, as I think it's somewhere in the Act that says that you cannot invest, anybody cannot invest in their own building, for example. But is that not your safest investment? I mean, if I'm looking at all these government buildings, the government is building. All these government offices, when COVID hit, before COVID, if private companies were building this and then selling it to government on a great prices, build, operate, transfer. What some other people are pushing now is a rent to own. If you look at government's rent bill in Namibia, you would be flabbergasted. And if you just, and that falls under, in the budget terms, it's recurrent expenditure. So it's easier to rent for 30,000 a month than to pay off a bond for the same building at 30,000 a month. Our restrictions are also in government. Now, if you apply that analogy into the space that we are operating in, we may need to go back to the semantics and analyze. Maybe Arfan should lead something like that to analyze. What does the regulator mean when they say property? What is the difference between property and infrastructure? We need to go to those things. Now, it was very funny, or not funny at all. I'm used to saying funny. But Rory, you mentioned parastatal bonds, right? And in Namibia, we are struggling to create spaces where parastatals can really access funds. We have, I think, two or three parastatals that have the ability to issue bonds, and that are issuing bonds. Is maybe you have three that has the ability, maybe two that actually does it. What about a pool? If we start introducing these type of things into that, is infrastructure funding. Another thing that I a pet issue of mine in Namibia is that in all our investment plans, Harambe, NDP, we plan, what we do is we borrow to spend. We don't borrow to build. I mean, you borrow to build a road. How are you going to recover? How is there any return on that investment? How do you quantify it? At least we have the tourism sector that does provide a return on that. A physical office. I was recently in the regions. The regional offices look so beautiful. Those beautiful 3, 4, 5-story buildings in a town where that is the only multi-story building. Is it really necessary? Where there's a lot of other vacant government buildings that could have just been renovated and repurposed. So these are the type of things that we need to, and us as the private sector, we need to push these things. So I think if one could create either a listed product or an unlisted product where parastatals could get funding for their projects, then even a small fund like NAMCOR could put their 500,000 into it and say that we have met the requirements of NAMFISA. And as Rory has said, in my work, my day job, I've seen I deal with private equity in funding the projects that we chase in the oil and gas industry. And it's correctly, as I said, the expenses are high, but normally your returns are high. So once you net it off, it sort of puts you on par with what you would get with the list. But it does provide you with access to a whole different funds. In the oil and gas industry, for instance, what we've experienced now, with all of this, no, we do not need to fund hydrocarbons and all of this. What has come strongly to the fore is the private equity guys. They say, no, we have money. We want to make money. We go in there. And this will lead us into the ESG and responsible investing later on. But it opens up new doors.
I need to stop you because you are giving a very good nuggets, wise nuggets that we must unpack. And before I lose my train of thought, you've touched on a lot of very good things. Don't go further. So we first unpack them. And I think you were hitting the nail on the head, trying to speak to responsible investors, that as pension funds and long-term insurers with our contractual savings, we should advocate for the control environment we want, so we can have the necessary ecosystem that will make private equity, sought with investment solutions. You very nicely went into innovation for capital market development, you know, when you spoke of possible infrastructure project bonds or trying to address and see how we can solve the issues with parastatics. And it comes back again to that restrictive regulatory framework, because unlisted investments is so much broader than just having to be confined to Reg 13.5, you know, which is classified under item 10. There's some very good things we can do in item 6 as unlisted property, some very good things we can do under item 8 as other claims, etc. So we really have to pull together, and I like that you said, where even a smaller pension fund like NAMCO can then pool its resources with bigger funds, that we all have a common goal, and direct our capital towards things that can drive solutions. But it does require us to advocate as an industry body, to really leverage on our asset base, because people are out there making decisions on our assets without trying to understand the risks and the impacts we face, even though we want to be part of the solution. So definitely there's a lot of capital market innovation that can occur, just on the asset lease back, where you say government has all these properties and maybe crying for money, is that, you know, you can have a buyback approach where then they lease back in the format of a bond and you release immediate cash. You may have heard during the time of when COVID was at its peak, that GIPF was trying to finance the local production of oxygen. That was going to be done in a manner where government did not need to come up with a big capex budget, but that, you know, we would fund it in such a way that they just have recurring expenditure towards procuring the oxygen. So you're very right, there's many solutions that we can come up with and have our contractual savings be placed into the real economy to benefit Namibians and our pension fund members at large at the end of the day. So very, very good that you raised that. And I think the framework within which, as an industry body, we can pull our minds together and advocate for this is to really recognize ESG. And I think we're not, as a pension fund body, speaking enough about ESG. Rory, I'd like to just ask you to just speak to the benefits of ESG, both from being a responsible investor and, most importantly, just how are you able to attract foreign direct investments from DFI into Namibia when you subscribe to certain things like ESG and making sure you have the right control environment, because a lot of times we speak to our peers in other markets at GIB and we say, well, we invest in your markets, come and join us and invest in Namibia. And they say, no, that unlisted framework you have in your regulations is a different animal on its own. Why can't you just follow best practice? I don't want to scratch my head and say, oh, when I come to invest in Namibia, I must appoint myself with this framework. So just the benefits of following best practice and keeping with momentum and trends to attract FDI into the country and to share risk as pension funds to have other institutional investors co-invest with us. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. I think you're right that the ESG practices in private equity are very well established, and you mentioned the DFIs, the development finance institutions who've invested across Africa in private equity funds for a long, long time. I mean, some even going back for 50 years, the different style of investing. So those practices have come through over a very long period of time and are pretty well bedded down. And are converging, thank goodness, the different standards set by the different development finance institutions have actually been coming together to a common view. You know, I think what you've got to recognize with these types of investments, with unlisted investments, is that when you invest, you can't sell them tomorrow. And that means you have a slightly different, you've got more of an attachment to the asset. You're more in bed with the assets for a long period of time. And that means you need to take into account the longer term risks and make sure you're managing the longer term risks and opportunity. And you're thinking about the kinds of things from an environmental, social, governance point of view that can affect a company or a project over a long time. You've got to be thinking about, I think probably the environmental impact component of ESG is the bit that people understand the best because it gets the most kind of coverage. But from a long term investment point of view, you need to be thinking about what is your sale prospect of the asset if it's something that is has an environmental impact. If you wind the clock forward for 5 or 10 years, then what does the market look like for the sale of that particular asset? Are your possible buyers still going to be interested in buying an asset like this if it is a particularly polluting asset? That's something that's really going to be considered. And then from the governance, when we talk about governance within the fund, but governance within the structures of either the projects or the companies that are being invested in. It's exceptionally important. You need to, if you're a private investor into a company, you need to make sure that luckily it's all, all of this, the right sort of frameworks are there, the best practice is there. None of this is fresh ground that actually has to be broken. It's more about just taking what's there and applying it. But it's becoming like an entrance ticket into this space. You can't run a private equity fund these days without strong consideration of ESG items throughout the investment process, from sourcing deals through your due diligence, considering the pricing, what you actually pay for the investment, and then through the holding period and exit has to be considered right throughout that process. But that's something from the pension fund point of view. We'd rather be looking that the manager is considering all of this. That's not something I'm saying that the pension fund should be doing. It's something that all the managers should be doing.
Thanks, Rory. Can I just understand if there's anyone who'd like to pose any questions or whether any questions have been posed on the virtual platform? And I can't see the light is extremely.
Yeah.
Maria?
All right, thank you so much, Rory, for that insightful presentation. Thank you, Sarah, thank you, Luca. I could see you were really sitting on the hat coming from a smaller fund. But now, what I want us to perhaps, Rory, you can share with us, because I think the challenge that Luca has shared with us is real. The obligation and the expectation for the smaller funds to comply with the regulation will remain. Now, I am just thinking, given your experience, because I see that you are also involved in the venture capital industry at the continental level, what can or is it certain, at the regional level, if I can put it that way. Now, I want you to share with us, what do you think our smaller pension funds can do? How can we assist them so that they can still comply with the regulation, given the challenges that they are faced with and the level of economies of scale for them to implement the regulation? Because I think what we are hearing is that the willpower is there, but the model itself is posing its own challenges in terms of the implementation in a very cost-effective manner. Now that's one. My other question is that, I just want us to reflect, as an industry. I always say there is a difference between a venture capital investor and a private equity investor, because I believe that their risk tolerance are different. Now, here in Namibia, we talk about the private equity, you know, industry. I understand, or I might be wrong, but I think there is a likelihood that there are some fund managers for 2 years who would not find investing companies to invest in. Now, what would be the problem? What has created illiquidity in that market? What can we do to create investing companies who become candidates to the private equity funders? Because I think the risk tolerance is completely different. Are we pitching at the right level when we determine our mandate in our governance documents, as you know, as you know, industry players, who is supposed to provide, you know, support? How do we create opportunities so that the private equity market can be vibrant and opportunities can come? Because I think from a policy point of view, I mean, we all see beautiful roads. We have seen the road authority is working hard to ensure that the road infrastructure is up to date. We have seen that Tanzania, for example, they are rehabilitating the railway so that, you know, the transport of goods can be facilitated efficiently. We have seen, for example, telecom carriers, they are all investing in the telecommunication infrastructure. My question is, do we have capacity? Because the return from that investment will come through the usage coming from the private sector. You know, that is what I'm thinking. How vibrant is our private sector? How prepared are we to ensure that we support a community which can be transported via our road infrastructure and exported elsewhere? How prepared are we as an industry, or what have we done to put these things in place? What can we share with us already from an African point of view? I'm sure we've done a lot of research. How can we improve and ensure that the enablers are in place to ensure the derivation of value from the exercise and, you know, the meeting of the government of GECO?
Sarah, shall I go ahead?
Yes, I will speak to what is very fully much in our context that you may not be familiar with. Yeah.
Okay, so there are quite a few questions that I think is fine to go through one by one. The first point is around the issue that everyone was speaking to earlier around the smaller pension funds. This is, you know, particularly in your environment, this is clearly an extremely important. If the regulator is going to maintain this, then, you know, you need a solution, you need a way to allow this in a way that makes sense to those institutions. You know, it doesn't take up all of their time to do it, and then it doesn't take up all of the government's time to monitor being a small part of the portfolio. So you need something that kind of fits those criteria. So, I mean, the way kind of the most obvious solution, I think, is in bringing, you know, a number of smaller pension funds together to work together. And there's different, you know, there's different ways that can happen. You know, for example, in Kenya, they came together as a group and they invested in a few different things together. You know, there's some. And in South Africa, there's a body that we want to do a similar thing. That's actually being launched this week. But, you know, it could equally be done through fund-to-fund structures or other types of structures. You know, in order to bring capital together and then, you know, not have it be a relatively passive investment for the actual pension fund, but bring the necessary skills and governance procedures to fit within that structure. And, you know, that's something that we can talk about more if you wanted to. I think on another point that you brought up that was involved with the SAFCA, the Venture Capital Association, because they play quite a role with potentially the revisions to regulation 28 earlier. SAFCA has played a big role in talking to bring that industry perspective to make sure that whatever gets drafted actually does make sense. And I think the process has been pretty good, quite consultative, and it's been very good to staff and be part of those discussions. I'm sure that staff would be very happy to participate in a discussion with the regulators here. I think it's maybe a whole part of the staff government place. So that's on that side. There was a question around where the opportunities come from. It's around the pipeline. And it's important to realize that in order for a deal to come to the table, there's gotta be a reason for the deal. So there's gotta be a driver. So that can come from a number of different areas. So for example, if it's a family business, sometimes that means that there's a transitional time in the family. So for example, maybe the founder of the business is getting to the age where he or she wants to pass on the business or start the process of passing on a Liverpool. Sometimes the Liverpool financing to allow the next tier of the management of the business to enable them to actually buy out the funder to take on that business for the next phase. That gives the shareholder of the business a way to exit and allows the new management to kind of for the next tier of management to kind of buy out. So it's got to be some reason. Businesses don't just look for capital just to get capital. And with private businesses, particularly family businesses, they're not particularly looking for outside shareholders. They like to do their thing. So there's got to be kind of a reason. Either they're seeing a growth opportunity, or there's some transitional change that needed, or they want to buy another business, or something like that. It's got to be kind of some traction. The second point I wanted to make is just that they are concerned about who gives them the money. They are concerned about what things come with the capital. And it's important that that it's clear and condition that funding comes with, and that whatever is set up, that is adhered to after that. Otherwise, you kind of can lose the trust of the market.
No, thanks, Rory. I'll start from the bottom, and I think it's a very relevant question because a lot of people confuse the risk pension funds can take. Pension fund capital is not sovereign wealth fund money. And there's this unfair expectation that because we have these contractual savings, we must fund everything under the sun in Namibia that will be impactful. In different geographies, you have development agencies or particular government agencies that provide the catalytic funding to have sort of a blended finance approach to unlock opportunity. And once it's commercially viable, pension fund money will trickle in. So in Namibia, we don't have well-funded development fund agencies and enough development finance institutions. So yes, we have the DBN, but we need the likes of NIDA, which in South Africa would be your, your industrial IDC, we need particular capital put aside when government wants to drive a certain social impact. When we look at venture capital, it is just a subset of private equity. So private equity, venture capital, all lumped together. So the category of 13.5 unlisted investments allows for them is actually what Nampisa wants to see. But the problem we have in Namibia is that we don't have angel investors. So it would be very unfair to expect pension fund money to fund Series A rounds where there's no proof of concept, etc. So this is the ecosystem we're talking about. The ecosystem must have all the role players for it to function optimally. Otherwise, we just expose pension funds to solvency risk, and we will, things can go wrong. So we must play in terms of our asset allocation objectives, which is driven by our investment objectives. We can't just invest for the sake of it. So I do believe once the ecosystem is duly filled with all the right role players, we will see a pipeline of opportunities. So you're very right in saying that at times it seems that the deals are too few, and so you have all this capital chasing few deals and driving up prices, which comes back to the notion Dugald alluded to earlier, that it is simply expensive investing into private equity in Namibia because of matters such as these. On the other issue you raised of how does a small pension fund access this market, it comes back to that controlled environment where we spoke of advisory boards. If experienced pension funds like GIPF could pool and we all pool together in one particular fund and there's an advisory board, there would be skills transfer. Even us as the GIPF have benefited from skills transfer when we invest offshore. I mean, a new asset class we ventured into in 2017 was venture capital. We invested in venture capital in US and China, and we relied on those advisory committees to have that learning curve. So I think that will address the issue of the small pension funds. I think we just need to follow best practices, and I think we want to do our own thing in Namibia, and that can pose significant risk. And all the policy initiatives that have been set forth in the Namibia Financial Sector Charter can fall flat if we don't make sure we secure the control environment, as your slide had it up earlier. With that said, ladies and gentlemen, we are nearing the lunch hour. I think maybe just one last question, if there is further question, and then we will release our delegates to go to lunch. And there goes the rain. I don't even know if someone has a question, whether we will be able to hear them. But Rory, allow me to take this opportunity to thank you for availing yourself. I'd also like to mention that 27-4 in South Africa incubates a lot of private equity fund managers. So what some pension funds in South Africa decided was to say it's too much headache dealing with private equity managers, particularly when they are new. We will rather deal with one entity than to deal with the underlying managers. So 27-4 does offer such services as well. The lunch hour is the